This week on Rockstar Superhero. When I found out I was going to chat with Mattias Ottosson of Swedish powerhouse Nekromant, I kind of lost my mind because I love his songs and I love the groove and the sound of the band. It's not so much that I was starstruck, but I wanted to create a good show and honor this musician that I enjoy so much. I think we accomplished what we set out to do because Mattias and I had a great time. I'm pretty sure we just became friends, and you, the listener, get to hear how it all happened on this show. Make sure you check out the latest release from Nekromant, Temple of Haal, and dig into this heavy, chunky, groovy sound with a classic twist. Their music is not to be missed, and yes, that rhymes. This is my conversation with the visionary singer and songwriter, Mattias Ottosson of Nekromant, on Rockstar Superhero. Well, welcome to the show, Mattias. How are you doing, brother?
Thank you. I'm doing very good. You know, it's the holidays are coming up, so I'm looking forward to a bit of time off.
Yeah.
How are you doing?
You know what, man? As evidenced by the Christmas tree and the very moody lighting in here,
yeah.
It's snowing like crazy outside today.
Where are you located?
So I'm about 30 miles east of Seattle in the United States. I don't know if you
know. Yeah, okay. I know where it is. Yeah,
okay, sure. So I live out in the mountains, so it's kind of cool. It's actually very cool, literally cool, and lovely here. Probably similar to where you live.
Oh yeah, that's for sure. I mean, we don't have snow at the moment, but we had a good amount of snow considering it's still early in the year. I live in the south of Sweden though, so we don't get like these crazy winters most of the time. It goes like in a 10 year interval.
Yeah.
When it's like really bad weather, you know, each 10 years it gets like maybe like 25 below zero Celsius. I don't know what that's in Fahrenheit though, but it's cold.
Yeah, that's amazing. I would love that for a bit of time. I don't think I could handle it. I'm kind of a pansy.
No, me too. I don't know. I like the cold, but I can't stand the heat in the summer. It's I don't like that.
Yeah. A friend of mine lives in Oslo, and he was telling me earlier the year that when it's 20 degrees Celsius, it's too warm.
Oh yeah, for sure. I mean, but it's really different here because it's it gets really how do you call it, moist outside.
Yeah, humid. Yeah,
it's not a dry heat. It's very moist, so it really gets to you. But it's fine. I mean, I live in a place where there's like really temperate climate, so I'm one of the lucky ones in Sweden. I was visiting the real north of Sweden like 2 or 3 weeks ago in Kiruna in Lapland.
Oh my god!
Those are the real weather guys up there. tell you.
Those are guys that are skiing to the South Pole.
Oh yeah, no. I think it was 27 below zero Celsius.
Oh my god!
The locals there, they kind of like wore a thick shirt. Not a jacket or anything. It was they're really good at that.
Yeah. Well, you said you're in South Sweden. So my research tells me, and I'm probably wrong because it's changed by now, and I don't know how to pronounce the name, but is it Vargon or Vargon? Or
what? You're pretty close. It's Vargön.
Okay.
The direct translation for it is Wolf Island, pretty much.
Wow.
It's not an island and there are no wolves, but it's a cool name still.
It is.
So, you're pretty much right on the money there. All three of us in the band are from Vargön.
Okay. And it's situated between two mountains that have sort of legend built around them.
Yeah, kind of. It's not like everybody in Sweden knows about these myths and legend. It's very much local. The kind of stuff you hear growing up around here. You're always... all the people around there are kind of familiar to the myths and stories, but no one was for real. So it's not like... it's not any based on any history or anything. It's just like really urban legends.
Right. But that Wolf Island thing, I mean, that's a great name for an album, man.
Yeah, yeah, sure. I mean, in Sweden, it would be kind of obvious, though, if we call it that. So we kind of went there, though, with not our latest album, but the album before that, The Nekromant Lives. We had a song called The Wolf's Mountain on there. And I think it was there the idea started out to make sort of a thematic record about these places.
Yeah, yeah. That makes a lot of sense. Yeah, I would think that it would be too obvious to anybody in Sweden. They'd be like, dude, seriously? Like, you couldn't try harder?
I don't. I'm not sure that all people in Sweden know where Vargen is, though. It's a small town about, I don't know, 6,000 people or something like that. So it's not on the normal Swedish person's map, I think.
Yeah, yeah. So you guys all are from that area. How did you guys connect? I mean, have you known each other all since childhood?
Not really. I mean, me and Adam, the guitar player, we hung out a lot. We still hang out a lot, but we hung out a lot when we were like 14, 15, 16, you know. We had a band together back then, also a heavy metal band pretty much. Yeah. And we kind of knew about the drummer. He was familiar to us, but we didn't hang out. We didn't know him for real. But we were all born in the same town, like I said, Vargen. The other two guys, they lived there until they was 18 and ready to move out. I moved from there with my family when I was about 7 or something. So I'm not a real, you know, local. as far as them they are concerned, I'm not a real local.
But, transplant.
Yeah. So but me and Adam, like I said, we were very close, and we always kind of knew about Jukka, the drummer.
Yeah.
And it just I don't know why. I think he heard our first like demo recordings and stuff like that, and he liked it, and then we asked him if he wanted to try out, and he did, and here we are.
Yeah. Was that the Serpent days, or is that pre-Serpent?
No, that is most definitely the Serpent days. Okay. As far as I'm concerned, I don't consider us being a band before we joined up with Jukka.
Gotcha.
Because, you know, in the beginning, we made one demo and one full-length album before, and that's not available anywhere, I think. But right. That was just like me and Adam in a studio with unlimited amount of time, you know? So that's not written to be a trio or anything like that. It was just us having fun. So I don't really consider that to be one of our records, even though we released it under the name Serpent back then. But it's not really what we're about. I consider us to have been born when we joined up with Jukka and made the first record with him.
Yeah. Well, you guys are incredible. The sound is really stunning. I mean, look, obviously you can hear, like with any band in the world, you're going to hear influencers of what you think you've heard before, because in a sense, nobody's doing anything new, right? It's all sort of accidental homage to what came before. But there are such great things that came before, you know? And so, I mean, you know, I've seen a lot of people compare you guys to Black Sabbath and Iron Maiden. But you know what I hear? I hear triumph.
And oh, really?
Yes. And it's because of your voice. Your voice sounds so much. Obviously, you weren't influenced by Rick Emmett. I get that. But
I don't think I've ever listened to Triumph, honestly.
Yeah.
So I'm not really sure how it sounds, but
oh my God. Canadian metal band from the 80s. Yeah. Mm-hmm. But just lay it on the line. You know what I mean? The shape, the timbre of your voice. It really reminded me of him. So I wanted to tell you that because I love Rick Emmett's voice.
So by
default, I love your voice.
Yeah, that's awesome. I've always obviously known that there's a Canadian band called Triumph, but I can't name a song from them. I don't think I've ever heard them, but I'll have to check it. They're a trio also as well, right?
Yes. Yeah. And I mean, they were pretty short lived. They didn't really do very well outside of Canada, but for a brief shining moment, they were huge, right? They played the US Festival in 1983. I mean, there's 350,000 people at that festival. So that had to be incredible. But Anyways, I just wanted you to know I love your voice.
Really. That's very cool. Thank you very much.
Yeah, yeah. You know, that so that begs the question that I always hate to ask, but I think it's important to ask, yeah. Especially as my listeners are getting to know people like yourself and they're discovering your band. Mm-hmm. There have been so many excellent heavy bands that have come before you, some that are groove-based, some that are traditional, you know, British New Wave, etc. But how do you pay homage to their styles and sounds that influence you without directly stealing from the bands that you love?
That is a good question. It's very difficult. It honestly is, because, you know, when you try to play like old school, if you want to call it that, heavy metal or classic heavy metal or whatever you want to call it, you're kind of bound to fall into that sometime, you know, to rip somebody off. You never intend to, but it's going to happen. We actually did it twice that I can recall, with our first demo and this unofficial album I talked about earlier. Mm-hmm. We had a song on there called The Ritual. And, you know, we made a song, it's a good song, and we released it twice on a demo and on an album. Mm-hmm. And I figured out like 2 years after that that's the exact riff from Angel of Light by Merciful Fate.
Oh my God.
Yeah.
Oh my God.
You know, recorded fucking twice. You know, it's.
Did you get any feedback? I mean, did you get any response from Merciful Fate?
No, none. And that makes me terrified that I may do it again, you know, that nobody says anything. So I'm kind of grateful when people like, oh, that's really close to that thing. And then I listen to it and then I kind of judge if it's like, is it too close, you know, or is it like in the same vein or whatever? That's fine. But this was like, you know, ba 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 da, da, ba ba. That was like exactly the same thing. So, it's a trap, and you have to kind of watch out, because I am, like many others with me, you know, I'm hugely inspired by Judas Priest and Rainbow and Manowar and stuff like that, and. You know, that's the music I heard when I was growing up, and that kind of never leaves you in a way. That always remains your biggest foundation.
Yeah.
So that makes you a little bit like closed into that box, you know?
Yeah.
And I'm happy to be there because I love the music, but that also makes you susceptible to these types of problems. Yeah. That you might have not listened to a song for a while, and then you write a riff and you love it, and it's because you've heard it thousand times before but can't remember it. So you have to be careful, but I feel like we're doing a pretty good job with staying on our lane, you know. We try to make it so it isn't a complete ripoff, but sure, it's hard. It's classic heavy metal, you're gonna rip somebody off sometime, so you just have to try not to, basically.
No, it's true. I mean, I think about this a lot, you know. People, I don't know what it's like for you, but whenever I go to, you know, a local store, a grocery store, or I don't know, a clothing store, it doesn't matter. I'll see somebody and I'll swear I've met them before. Mm-hmm. I live in a fairly small town, so maybe I have, but I've been thinking about this a lot lately, that maybe it's just once, maybe 5 years ago, I was passing them on the highway and you look over in the car and you see that face and you imprint it, right? You don't forget it. And I think it's the same thing with music. I don't know if it's possible. I mean, obviously it's possible to create sort of your own version and your own sound, but I don't think it's possible to not have unintentional musical homage to the bands that you grew up on, you know. I mean, if you play a galloping, everybody's going to say, oh, it sounds like Run to the Hills. And I'm like, I guess, because it has a galloping beat.
Yeah. And it's true. I mean, it does sound like Run to the Hills, especially if you're like in that vein of music, you know, that you play like classic heavy metal, it's going to happen, but it's fine. I mean, obviously there's bands doing completely new stuff. Mm-hmm. And I've talked about this with several people over the years, that it's very exciting to think about which bands are totally unique. Mm-hmm. It's not many bands that are totally unique. Obviously, all bigger bands are kind of unique because they're, you know, they will never be a band that does exactly what they do, because then it will be a ripoff. But it also implies that or how should I put it? Some bands are so unique that there will be never another band that will ever even sound like them.
Right.
It would be a ripoff. You know, nobody can sound like Rush.
Right. Nobody.
Because if you sound like Rush, then you're a ripoff of Rush because they're one of a kind.
Yeah. Yeah.
Nobody will sound like Blind Guardian, for instance.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because then you would absolutely be a ripoff.
Right.
But you know, you can't say that about Metallica and Iron Maiden because they are, I mean, obviously they're unique bands, but they have a much broader sound, if that makes sense.
Yeah. No.
You can pick and choose a little bit from it.
It does. It does. And I think the best bands in the world, I don't want to say they don't mind, but I think for the most part, they're pretty good with it because, I mean, if anything, it's you know, it's a way of saying, look, I'm influenced by you. This is what I love. It's your fault, right? Yes, like I would want to be an influencer to that level.
Yeah, I mean, sure. And like I said, you know, if you're going to play this music, you're going to have that problem at some point because you can't really... A lot of bands have, like, you know, died on the altar of evolution.
Yeah.
They have tried to do something completely different, something new, something unique, and it turns to shit, you know? Mm-hmm. Like Lulu, Metallica.
Yep.
That is, I mean, we don't have to talk about that. we don't have to even bring that up.
Yeah, I don't think I've ever listened to the whole thing, ever.
I don't think anyone has. It's horrible, but you know, it's fair game, to fair play to them. It was a try. They did it, and that was came out. Mm-hmm. But you know, some part of the band dies with that because you open up to the possibility of you sounding like that, and that's not a good thing for people to have in their minds. Mm-hmm. You know that okay, Creeping Death is a great song, but they also did this. You know, that's not for me. That kind of matters a bit, but it's hard, man. I'm not the one to judge anyone. I mean, about what they do, but you're gonna have problems with that if you're gonna play classic heavy metal or classic power metal or classic black metal or whatever.
Well, I mean, we're humans. We can't help but be influenced by the things we hear, and we can't help but have an opinion. And and some of us, like myself, and I imagine you, we tend to be a bit louder about our opinions because, well, we do this for a living. This is right. Sure. This is the space we exist in. We occupy this, and honestly, we have something to say. You know, so pay attention.
I mean, it's it would be weird to have me on your show here and I didn't have any opinions on anything. That would be a bad show.
Yeah.
So I try to be maybe more opinionated than I really am during these times, you know, because it's fun. It's fun to talk a little bit of shit, you know.
Yeah. Yeah, that's right. Let's talk shit, man. Well, this is the Christmas episode, as you can see by the tree behind me and the fact that I have no bright white lights on in front of me.
Yeah.
So let's talk about cultural influence. Is that cool?
Sure.
You know, every band, every time I talk to a band, you know, I'm asking them, you know, like, what was the sound you listened to when you were growing up? Or what's your favorite song? I mean, these are things we always have to ask. But sure. I don't think we talk about cultural influence enough because you aren't just Swedish, but you're from a very specific area that you have mentioned many times that most people probably don't even know where it is. What do you think it is about your community or your family in the community that turned you into the musician and creative that you are?
Wow, that's a huge question.
Dangerous question, maybe.
Well, I mean, I think maybe it's got something to do with that I even had the choice of doing this, you know, because my family they're not musicians by any means. They kind of like music as anyone does, you know, but they're not super interested. They're not really passionate about it in any way. But they always, you know, kind of supported that I would play music. They always wanted me to. I remember when I was a kid, and they always wanted me to start playing an instrument. You know, didn't really matter what instrument, just an instrument.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Like in the music school, I think they pictured something like the violin or the cello or something like that.
Sure.
And I mean, I actually played the cello in like fourth grade or something at school. But I was approached at school by Adam and another guy called Ludwig. And they had formed a band. This was when we were like 14. And they asked me if I wanted to play the drums. And you know, memory is a fucked up thing. You can't really remember exactly how it happened. But my recollection of it was that they asked, can you play drums? I had never seen a drum kit in real life. Mm-hmm. And I was like, yeah, sure I can.
And you're doing your best Nikki Six impression. Sure, I can play bass.
Sure, I can. No problem. I mean, I was wearing like a Man of War hat, which they saw, and I was like, oh, that guy needs to play drums. And I was shortly after that, I changed my mind. I wanted to play the bass because I don't remember why, but I had no training or nothing. But, you know, my family were always like, oh, that's great. I don't think that was what they pictured when they thought that I was going to play an instrument. But they were like, oh, you're going to play an instrument. That's awesome. Even though they had no interest in it, really. Yeah. So, I mean, that opened up a doors, absolutely. That just being able to have the choice. I mean, in a lot of families, for a lot of kids, they don't have that choice because that's not something you do. That is like pointless, you know?
Yeah.
Study to be a doctor instead. That's way better. But so just being able to have the free choice definitely helped me. And I mean, as far as creativity goes, who knows? I like to write songs and I've practiced it a long time. And that's a skill as anything else, you know, to write songs. It's not like, for most people at least, it's not like you're going to be awesome at it the first time you try. You have to practice. I mean, I actually have an old hard drive with my oldest stuff from when I was like 14. And that's terrible, you know? It's way, way bad.
But I bet you there's stuff in there that if you pick it out, I bet you there's nuggets in there, though.
It might be. I haven't looked at it with like a positive mind, I think. I looked at it more like fun. But who knows why people are creative. I mean, it just happens. I think it's based out of joy of what you're doing. If you like doing it, then you're probably going to do it a lot, and then you're probably going to get better at it.
Yeah. Oh, man, that is such a great answer. And it's a word I use a lot, Mattias, which is joy.
Yeah.
You have to be in love with something in life to have any sort of success. And I'm not talking about monetary success. I'm just talking about...
I've had none of that, believe me.
Right. But just doing anything that is not only pleasing to yourself, but potentially pleasing to others. You have to love what you're doing, and you have to do it for yourself first. Absolutely. And if other people enjoy it down the road, great. And if a whole bunch of people enjoy it down the road, then maybe you'll make a little bit of coin. But if you don't do it because you love it, like, I mean, look, I love this. I suck at it. But
no, you're fine. This is great.
But I love it because I get to connect with guys like you who are doing something really important in the world, and they're elevating the genre and they're new and they're inspiring. And then you discover, like me, that, oh, you're not new. You've been around a while, but I hadn't heard of you. You see what I'm saying? And I think that is the greatest joy that I have personally, is being able to stumble across these incredible musicians and works of art and help expand right their I don't want to use the word notoriety, but, you know, right, their thing out into the world. I get to bark it at the world and say, check this out. You know what I mean? Yeah. So joy is everything.
Yeah, I wouldn't agree that I'm doing something important in the world, though. I mean,
I think you are.
I'm a fucking jester. I stand on stage with tight pants and sing with high notes. That's not important. That's fun. That's a good time. If that doesn't help humanity in the slightest.
Oh no! But see, now I'm gonna disagree with you. Now, oh. Now here, let me just hear me out, okay?
Yeah.
I think it. Okay, so look at it this way. Let's take 10 bands that are. Mm. That plays similarly to you. I'm not going to name the other nine, but just imagine in your head, there's 10 bands that all play similar style of music, right? Yeah. Everybody has a unique voice, regardless of how similar it is.
Sure.
And the most important thing you can pursue is your own purity. And what I mean by that is you write what you write for your band, and your trio sounds exactly like and only like Nekromant. Like, yeah. You see what I'm saying? Yeah. And so even though from the surface, it's easy to look at you and poo-poo it and say, oh, there's the guy in the tight leather pants singing a style of music I've heard before. There's nothing to it that you know, floats my boat, makes me happy. Mm. But there is another guy standing right next to that guy that hears it and says, wow, that is new and unique and completely different. And it's now one of my favorite things.
Absolutely true. I mean, sure, you're right.
Right, right.
It is very subjective what you find appealing, I guess.
It is.
And it can be the simplest things, you know?
Yeah.
It can be like, I've always been into heavy metal. I mean, ever since I can remember, I've never really been into another music form. I mean, I've differed from all the way from fucking Motley Crue to Mayhem, sure. But yeah. it's still guitar in the end of the day, you know.
Yeah.
But it can be the smallest things that pluck your interest in it. It can be like I heard this classical piece, what do you call it, classical music, classical piece of work or whatever, the other day. And it was something that I've never heard. I don't remember the name of the composer. He was a famous Russian composer. And my girlfriend who's played classical music for like 20 years, plays the flute, great at it. She was like, oh, that's that guy. That's like that's a normal Russian composer. And right. When I listened to it, it was something that I never heard before. It sounded so weird and so like powerful. It was something about like spring ritual.
Oh, Stravinsky.
Yeah, exactly. that's a fucking bullseye right there.
yeah. It's a rite of spring.
Yeah, sure. That's it. I'm not extremely experienced in classical music, but I've heard my fair share, you know. And that was something that I've never heard of. And she was like, yeah, that's a normal Russian composer we're talking about. Yeah. So it's like, it can be like the smallest things that you hear. And sometimes she says to me like, oh, this song sounds like that song. And I'm like, no, it doesn't. Yeah, listen to this. Oh, it kind of does.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
But it can be like the smallest things. And you can only find those things, I think, if you're being like honest about your music taste, you know?
Yes. The only reason I said what I said, Mattias, and I hope it didn't offend you, is that I find over and over again in these conversations with different musicians that I find extraordinary, and I do it too, we all tend to devalue our place in, you know, in the pantheon of artistry, right? In music or in cultural value or just being a, you know, like just being somebody you want to hang out with. Most people kind of heap, you know, scorn on top of themselves. And the reality is you, my friend, are fucking badass. And your music is badass. I mean, I love it. When your PR director, when she sent me your demo, but your latest record, I mean, yeah. I'm not gonna lie. Just like you said, I had never heard of you. Stravinsky is one of these huge composers and you've never heard of him.
No.
But here we are talking.
Yeah.
And we're talking because somebody who is equally passionate said, you two need to connect.
That's right.
And that is amazing to me. And that's what I love about this. So my next question for you would be, do you have to be negative or do you have to have dissonance? You've already answered the question. In life to create great music.
I don't think so. I don't think you have to be negative. If that was your question, if you need to be like a little disturbed or
a little edgy. Right now. Yeah, yeah.
I don't think so. I mean, I have no idea how other people do it. I just know how I do it, and I know that when I'm at my happiest, I am most creative. So I don't. If I'm like having a bad period in one way or another, I can't focus on music. You know, that is too much work. I can't bear that mentally when I'm feeling bad. Mm-hmm. But when I'm happy, I can do. I mean, we have just released this album, and 75% of the next album is already done. Wow! So I'm very fast when I'm in a good place, you know.
Yeah.
I don't think you need to be anything negative to be able to create. I don't think so. But you kind of, that depends. If you count like being pessimistic as negative,
sure.
I'm not sure that's a negative trait to be a little bit of a pessimist, you know?
Yeah.
Because some people may call it a realist. I'm not sure. Nobody knows what a realist is because nobody knows what the fuck is going on anyway.
nobody knows, man. It's all the glasses. Yeah. It's the glass isn't half full or half empty. The glass just has water in it.
Yeah. I mean, that's not... sure. But I don't think it's negative to be a little bit of a pessimist. And I don't think you need to be negative to create, but to be able to write the lyrics and maybe especially the topics that I'm writing about, you kind of have to be a little bit of a pessimist. Maybe. But I don't consider that to be bad.
Yeah. The funny thing is, though, is here I am talking to this great guy who's really cool and really interesting and full of joy. And he's telling me that sometimes you need to have some negative stuff in there. But you're such a seemingly positive guy. You know what I mean? Like you've written, like you said, 75% of this new record. Mm-hmm. So you have it all in you. It's just timing. I mean,
things
come out when they're supposed to come out, right?
And you know, we never do like premeditated choices about what our next album's gonna sound like or how it's gonna be or anything. But I did make one premeditated choice in preparation for the Temple of Haal album, and that was to write lyrics about stuff that excited me and made me happy rather than made me angry or sad.
Wow.
And that was, I don't know why, I just felt like I wanted to do that. So I did it. And it was kind of surprising because some of the songs, you know, came out like about the local myths and legends and stuff that really tickles my fancy, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the songs are about the Lord of the Rings character, Gandalf, you know, All Odin's Song.
Mm-hmm.
But many of them came out like really dark, which was surprising because I was a little bit worried that it was going to come out like too bright maybe with all this like fantasy based stuff. But one of the songs that we chose as the second single for the album, Behind the Veil of Ice, that is a really, I mean, you couldn't imagine somebody writing that for the purpose of being happy maybe. But, you know, it's different what you consider exciting or happy. I mean, a happy place can be, as in that song, for instance, it can be an acceptance and a peace before an impending doom, for instance.
Yeah.
There is happiness in there, you know?
Yeah.
And you can explore that in the lyrical context.
Yeah, and it's such a different piece compared to, say, The Woods.
Oh, yeah. It's 100% different. It's very different. And they do kind of, though, share a little bit of the lyrical stuff because The Woods is like really, it's not sad, but it's a little bit pissed off, you know? It's about like a small observation on modern society. I don't claim to have any answers for anyone. I'm not pushing any message or anything. It's just an observation. But they're both like really dark songs in a way, but that makes me happy in a way. That makes me excited.
Yeah. I think that's what draws me to it, though. It's all the things, right? It's the sonics. I mean, it's literally the sound of the record and the way it was produced.
That's very important.
Yes, it's huge, and most people don't understand how big it is.
Yeah.
But the sound of the record has a classic mix. That's the best way I can put it. But it's a killer headphone record. But your voice, it's like Rush. You know, you were talking earlier that, you know, Rush. Nope, nothing sounds like Rush, and that is true. Yeah. But I think when we get down to it, it isn't just the musicianship, but it's the tight clinical production of it. Like, right? Because the sound of those records, there's very little reverb. There's like no decay. Everything is very honest. Is right, right. The guitar tones are very glassy, but it's Getty's voice that stands out. There's just no matter. Neil's obviously one of the most fantastic drummers of all time. Yeah. Alex's guitar playing has been always underrated. It's extraordinary, but it's Getty's voice that makes you go, "I love Rush" or "I can't stand Rush." It's so polarizing.
Yeah,
and your voice is just so damn good. So damn good. I know there's no question here, but
I'll take it. It's fine.
I'm just so excited that I'm talking to you right now. Let me ask a question. Nekromant. You guys have been together about 10 years. Is this correct?
Not really. I would say let's see. 6-7, I think.
Okay. So maybe it's not so much, but you released three albums?
Four.
Okay. So you've actually churned out quite a bit of material in a fairly short amount of time. Yeah. So that's not traditional at all. You know what I mean?
No. I mean, if anything, I'm frustrated that it's so slow. Because it's really the industry that is slow, you know? Yeah. When you're going to look for which we have now, we have a new label, and you know, that is, I'm very happy with them so far, but that is always a time consuming element, you know, to find a new label and to wait for them to do their PR and stuff like that. And everything moves really, really, really slow. Mm-hmm. I'm not saying that the labels that we have or had are particularly slow. I think they're actually kind of fast, but I'm a person that appreciates, you know, I get frustrated over the stupidest shit, you know. I get frustrated about time-consuming stuff all the time, all the time. You know, if I'm going to move out of this room and shut the light off, and if I, like, miss the light switch, I'm not going to stop. I'm going to keep going and just, fuck it, I'll do it tomorrow. It's like, I'm so restless, you know.
You and I are the same. Oh, my God. And it's all about efficiency. Like, you're telling your brain as you're walking out, make sure you hit the light. Make sure you grab the things. I'm not coming back.
No, I'm not coming back. And I have the unfortunate ailment of being lazy and restless at the same time. Mm. And that makes for makes for a fucking head trauma, you know. But it's I mean, it's I acknowledge that we have released a lot of material in a fairly short number of years, but I don't feel in any way that we have rushed anything.
It's,
we really take our time. I mean, I would like to have more time in the studio, but that's more of a money thing, you know.
Yeah.
But I don't feel like we have had a plan to release and release and release. You know, it's fun to write songs. I love to write songs, and I love to write a new song and take it to the other guys and show them and see if they like it. And we are very similar in our musical foundations, you know, that I kind of know if they would like it.
Yeah.
So it's very rewarding to be able to do it. You know, I have a small home studio. I can do it like fast and efficient and take it to them with a skeleton of a song, and we can construct it together to complete it. So it's very rewarding. And I guess that is why we are so perceived as so fast or fast moving.
Yeah. Well, I mean, and again, that's not a slight from me. I think it's amazing because it shows skills that most people don't have. It's hard to be prolific, you know, to do it well. You know what I mean? And again, listening, I mean, once I discovered you, it's like, okay, I hear this. I listen to Temple of Haal, and it's like, oh my God, this is great. You know, then I want to go back and start analyzing and comparing to the older material so I can see how you've grown. You know what I mean? Because that's very interesting to me. The progression of the band is really, really fascinating.
Yeah, you know? I mean, we have done a lot of, I talked earlier about evolution in bands, that I don't necessarily think that it's only a good thing, but we have done quite a bit of evolution. I mean, obviously we still have the same foundations in Black Sabbath and Rainbow and Judas Priest and so on.
Yeah,
but we have done a fair bit of evolving. I mean, I feel now that we're closer to what we want to do than ever before.
Yeah.
And that kind of comes with being closer to maybe the more epic side of heavy metal, you know, than we've been before. Before we were more riff-based. We're still very riff-based, but we were more about the slower songs and stuff like that. We often got clumped together with the resurgence of stoner and doom retro bands, you know?
That's
fine. I mean, I like many of those bands, but that's not really what we're going for. It's so I feel very happy that the other guys as well wanted to go in the direction of a little bit more more Swedish, I would say, maybe. A little bit more Scandinavian, not based in the desert rock or whatever. It's very melodic, I think.
Yeah. Yeah. No, I mean, I love it. I'm a big, huge fan of the stoner and doom stuff as well. Anything with groove is always, you know, is good in my book, because there's the bounce, right? The thing that just makes you go like, oh yeah. But you can do that with anything if it's good, right?
Yeah, you can.
I mean, you know, Rendezvous Point is one of my favorite bands from Norway. And they're a progressive metal band, and they're very melodic and very traditional progressive metal. And they're writing songs in 5 and 7 and 9 and 11, and they bounce. So, you know, there are bands that have figured it out.
We talked about Rush earlier. I mean, do they have songs in 4-4? I don't know. But
very few.
They still, I mean, they're still jamming, or whatever you call it over there in America. But it's I mean, it's still great. You can't argue with a good song, even if it doesn't matter if it's in 7-4. It's that doesn't matter at all.
Well, okay, so with this, the fourth release, Temple of Haal, it just came out like a week and a half ago. What's the public response? You know, I mean, are people digging it as much as
I think so. I mean, we have, that's a tricky thing to answer, really, because I was going to say, like, I've not had any bad response, but of course nobody says that to me. I've only had good response, and I had the response that I kind of anticipated in a way, that people are like, what, this is good. This is a little different from what you've done before. I'm happy that people realize that in a way. Not that we want to change particularly, but we have been moving towards the more classic epic side of heavy metal for a while. And I'm happy that we got a chance to, like, really express it, you know? Not just nibbling at it, but just really going for it. We don't have as many, you know, blues riffs now as we had before. I love blues riffs, but, you know, you pendle shifts and turns, you know, so you kind of have to do something different, and I'm very happy with how people have responded to it. It's fun to see people that maybe are not into metal as such. We're like, you know, good friends of mine that are not into music pretty much at all, and they like, is this your band? Is this you? This sounds really good. Well, fucking thank you. that's fun. So, yeah, overall, it's been incredible response.
Yeah. Well, that's awesome. I mean, you are correct that people do tend to tell you what you want to hear.
For sure.
But I do love that you're getting the feedback that you're getting. So it's not just weird guys like me heaping praise. You know what I mean? But I think it has to be. I'm a drummer, and I left the music business in 2003. I couldn't take it anymore. I was too frustrated with other people's sort of, and I'm not saying people that I played music with. I don't want to throw those guys under the bus. But just the general nature of the music business and the frustration of, if you didn't hit a specific criteria at a specific moment that somebody thought was important, nobody was going to pay attention. And I imagine it has to be insanely difficult now with YouTube and, you know, all the social media, because there's so much content out there. And yet, it's so cool, Mattias, because your music has finally found my shore, right? I finally discovered it, which means you're doing two things right. You're actually writing material that people are paying attention to and they're positive about. And two, you either have hired the right, you know, promotional, you know, people, label people, etc. Or they're doing their jobs better, maybe. Yeah. But the point is you're finally being heard. And so you've just got to stick to your guns, because the thing that I found about metal in general is a lot of metal bands never really pop. They don't, you know what I mean? They don't get like popularly famous. They get known on a festival circuit. You know, they end up at Wacken or you know, Hellfest or whatever. But the thing is those fans never go away. You know what I mean? They're tried and true. So, I mean, to me, you're only building a fan base. It's never going to leave you.
I mean, it's, I agree with you. It's I think it's kind of ridiculous the way I hear some other bands talk about this stuff, because it's no human right to have anyone pay attention to you.
Right.
That's a luxury. Mm-hmm. If anyone does it, that cannot be the main reason why you play music. Mm. It can't be that someone will pay attention to you or to make money. In that case, that's the wrong business. Mm-hmm. But I mean, it's I'm very happy that people are listening to us and are paying attention and you know, coming to the shows and whatnot. But that is not the thing, you know. I mean, it's, of course, that's the thing when you play live. You always want people to come and have a good time when you play live. But to be able to play live, you first have to write an album and do all this other stuff. And I've found that, you know, I really can't care too much about that stuff, because I can't really affect it. The only thing I can affect is to try to write as good an album as I can. And we can only do that. And if we do that, then we have a good foundation, if you will, to maybe have some recognition down the line. Maybe. Yeah. I mean, that's a big maybe. But I don't know. One thing that I heard in an interview with Lemmy of Motorhead kind of stuck with me. I think they asked him, I might be paraphrasing, but I think they asked him, like, how have you kept the band alive for so many years? It was like their 40th anniversary or 30th or something. Yeah. And he said, like, well, we never quit.
Yeah.
And that was like the main reason. It was not like he didn't lay out any complaints about band members or labels or the evil music industry or whatever. He just like, no, we didn't quit, so people kind of have to listen to us now because we've been around for so long, you know. So I mean, that really resonates with me, because that tells me that somebody like that was really doing it because he enjoyed it. It was like a good life, you know. And that's gotta be the main reason, I think, to do it. Of course, you can start a band and like intend to make the big bucks and be like the most famous band in the world. Who am I to judge? You might make it. Fuck do I know. But you probably won't. You'll have a better time trying to be an astronaut.
Yes. And you make more money too.
Most definitely. I mean, I don't really feel like I can worry too much about that stuff. Now it feels like we have a good label with good PR people that maybe can, you know, help us with that stuff. And that's great. But the only thing I really can control is how the album turns out. And if I'm feeling happy with the album, I'm supposing that other people will find it cool as well. And, I just kind of have to take it from there, you know. I can't really be analyzing too much about who likes it and who doesn't and why doesn't they or why do they. I'm extremely happy if people like it, but I'm not in this business to like make it big. I would be excited, of course. I mean, that would be awesome to play the biggest shows and the biggest festivals. But I'm fine now, you know. Mm. And as long as we in the band keep together and keep friends with each other, I'm sure we will continue for a long time.